Okay, here's the last list of representative heroes for this quarter. We'll start off by winding up the career of Henry VIII, and then hear about his contemporary Francis I, whom we met briefly last time as his wrestling opponent at the Field of the Cloth of Gold. Francois Rabelais can represent cultural accomplishment in Francis's day, and he's always ranked among the very greatest French authors. We'll also see several fine chateaux of the sort for which Francis's reign is famous. He died in 1547, the same year as Henry VIII, and we'll come right back then to hear about the troubles of his heirs, Edward VI and Mary Tudor, and then about the glorious reign of his daughter Elizabeth I, which some consider the greatest era of men and minds in English history. And it does, of course, include Shakespeare, who would probably get the most votes if we were to hold a worldwide contest to name the greatest dramatist in history. So last time at the end of the lecture, I was showing some of the portraits done by Holbein in England. And this picture in the London National Gallery, known as The Ambassadors, is usually considered his masterpiece. It was painted in 1533, and its subjects are, on the left, Jean de Danteville, who was French ambassador to Henry VIII at the time, and on the right, Georges de Selve, who was a French bishop. The picture is full of things which seem to have symbolic importance. Overall, I think the things on the carpeted shelf are meant to refer to heaven, the things on the shelf below are meant to refer to earth, and the weird thing at the bottom, which is actually a distorted skull, represents hell. It only looks like a skull, however, if you look at it with your face right next to the edge of the frame. Some think this is meant to be a kind of signature. The word Holbein in German can mean skull, but Holbein doesn't use it as a signature in any other known work. The prominence of the skull gives a kind of scary quality to the whole picture, and there are other references to death in it as well. Jean de Danteville has a silver skull on his hat, and the lute has a broken string, which is also sometimes used as a symbol for death or for transitory earthly things. The choice of books on the shelf is also interesting. The one to the left is for some reason the prosaic Arithmetic for Merchants, but the one closer to the Roman Catholic bishop on the right is open to the Lutheran hymn, Come Holy Ghost, Our Souls Inspire. The whole picture is a tour de force of technical skill on a grand scale. It's the largest picture Holbein ever painted, and the figures are essentially life-size. This is Holbein's portrait of Christine of Denmark. After the death of Jane Seymour in 1537, Henry was in need of a wife again, and after appointing Holbein to be court painter, he sent him off to do portraits of a couple of prospective candidates, including this girl, who was 16 at the time, but was already a widow, having been married to Francesco Maria Sforza, the son of Leonardo da Vinci's patron Ludovico, who died in 1535, and for whom she is still wearing black. Henry was impressed by this picture of her, and marriage negotiations were begun. But she backed out, allegedly remarking that she wouldn't marry the King of England unless she were given a spare head. She married the grandson of René of Anjou instead. This is Holbein's portrait of Anne of Cleves, who was pushed forward as a candidate by Cromwell, who wanted Henry to marry someone with Protestant connections on the continent and someone who might influence the king to be himself more of a philosophical Protestant rather than just the boss of the church in England. It has been said that Cromwell suggested to Holbein that it might be worth his while to make her look as good as possible. I don't know about that, but in any case, Henry felt misled by both this picture and written reports of her alleged beauty. He did go through with the marriage, but he blamed Cromwell for talking him into the union against his will, and he had him arrested and executed 3 months after the wedding for, in effect, having arranged a really bad blind date. Thank you. Here's one of the most famous portraits Holbein painted, and it's also probably the most famous image of Henry VIII. It's in the Rome National Gallery now. In this picture, Henry's actually wearing the outfit that he wore when his marriage to Anne of Cleves took place. And it's likely that we should also regard it as a Mr. Hans original as well. Like Leonardo, Holbein made money on the side as a fashion designer, and this is his most famous creation, apart from the costumes the beefeaters wear, I guess. Anyway, the king doesn't look happy on his wedding day. He claimed, in fact, that at the ceremony, although he had said, "I do," he had meant, "I don't." And when Anne agreed that the marriage had never been consummated, it was annulled. She was given a pension and spent the rest of her life in England until she died an old maid. This is one of the last portraits Holbein painted, and the subject is Henry's fifth wife, the 19-year-old Catherine Howard, whom he wed just a few months after the aborted marriage to Anne of Cleves, and on the very day he had Cromwell's head cut off. She was from a die-hard Catholic family, which might seem strange, but the marriage was perhaps in part intended to rebuild some bridges to the old-line nobility that remained Catholic, especially in the North. In any case, within a year, she admitted to having had several affairs before the marriage, and it soon became clear that she had been misbehaving since it as well, most notoriously with one Thomas Culpepper, to whom she had been engaged before marrying Henry. This disclosure incensed Henry, and she was executed for treason in February of 1542. On the scaffold, her last words are said to have been, "I die the wife of the King of England, but I'd rather die the wife of Thomas Culpepper." This is Catherine Parr, who became Henry's last wife in 1543, and who at 31 had already outlived two prior husbands. She was the daughter of a prosperous landowner and the sister of William Parr, whom Henry regarded highly and who became one of his real favorites for his part in the defeat of the Scots at Solway Moss in 1542. This is, I suppose, obviously not a portrait by Holbein. When Holbein died, the English were forced to fall back on their own third-rate painters, and this picture by a soi-disant artist is more of an illustration, really, than a work of art. Catherine herself, though, is universally praised for the tact and general good sense she showed in dealing with Henry, who became more and more vindictive and tyrannical as he grew older. This is thought to be a copy of what was probably the last portrait of Henry which Holbein painted. The king would have been no more than about 52 at the time, but he had lived life in the fast lane and was beset by all sorts of physical problems, including ulcers, gout, syphilis, though they didn't slow him down as much as one might suppose. He bullied the Scots, briefly invaded their ally France, kept the headsman busy with his political and religious enemies, came close to condemning his brother-in-law, William Parr, for unwelcome opinions on how to handle the Scots, and even Catherine herself was briefly in danger for more unwelcome opinions on how to handle religion. Henry seems to have been the last to recognize that he was near death, but he did die in early 1547. Jane Seymour's brother, Edward Seymour, the Duke of Somerset, was to be the regent for the 10-year-old Edward VI, and we'll be back to hear about his reign and about those then of his half-sisters Mary and Elizabeth in just a little bit. Jean Clouet's portrait of Francis I as a little boy. Like Queen Elizabeth, about whom we'll hear later, he was one of his country's most celebrated monarchs, but was a real dark horse to ever reach the throne at all. For Francis to become king, both Louis XII and Charles VIII, his predecessors, had to die with no sons. And in the 500 years of the Capetian succession in France, this kind of thing had never happened. Francis was the son of the Duc d'Angoulême, in fact, who was the great-grandson of Charles V. Here he is now as a grown man, again painted by Jean Clouet, and Jean and his son François were the two most important French artists of the 16th century, although you may remember from the Italian Renaissance class that Leonardo da Vinci spent his retirement at Amboise and brought Mona Lisa with him, and some actually think that painting had an influence on this portrait. The pose is similar, and Francis also has a sort of puzzling smile on his face. In any case, this was probably painted just about the time Francis succeeded Louis XII in 1515 and locked his widow, the sister of Henry VIII, up in the Hotel de Cluny to make sure she didn't provide his predecessor with a posthumous heir, as we've heard. Francis immediately began planning to invade Italy. Like Louis XII, he was descended from Gian Galeazzo Visconti and claimed Milan as well as everything else his army might get. The Emperor Maximilian was supporting the Sforza dynasty in Milan, represented by Massimiliano. This is an anonymous watercolor sketch of the Battle of Marignano, probably the biggest battle fought in Italy in 1,000 years. It was the main event in the conflict over Milan, and the French, with Francis fighting in the forefront of the hottest action, as you see him doing here, beat Massimiliano Sforza and his German backers. Each side had some 25,000 men, and about half the total were killed or seriously wounded. The French composer Jacques Maderne wrote a famous piece of music to commemorate this French victory called the Bataille de Marignan, and it was used as something of a French national anthem for a long time, and we'll hear it now while we see some more things relevant to the battle. This is a manuscript painting again of Francis at Marignano. On his tomb at Saint Denis, he's also shown in action there. This is a suit of armor that belonged to him, in which I guess he could have worn at the battle. It's now in Les Invalides Merit Military Museum. And this is his sword. After the victory, Francis went home, leaving Charles de Montpensier, the Duke of Bourbon and Constable of France, in charge. But soon there were problems about money and who was supposed to be paying to support the forces in Milan, and Bourbon was recalled in 1520. And then he got into a squabble with the king over his wife's inheritance the year after that and deserted to the empire. Audet de Lautrec was sent to replace him in Milan, but he was driven out by the imperialists in 1522, primarily, he claimed, because of, again, poor support and financing from Paris. This is the Chateau of Aizé-le-Rideau in the Loire Valley, and Gilles de Berthelot, who was an assistant to Francis's treasurer Jacques de Semblancay, built this. Francis blamed Semblancay for the problems in Milan, but Semblancay blamed the king's own mother, Louise of Savoy, for diverting money that was supposed to go to the army to other purposes. Francis sided with his mother, and Semblancay, who most modern historians think was innocent, was executed, and his assistant Gilles de Berthelot of Aizé here fled into exile. Many actually give credit for the charm of this chateau to Berthelot's wife Philippe, who apparently at least consulted closely with the builders. It has a few Italian touches, like the pilasters beside the windows, but it really is like Hampton Court. Renaissance only by date. This was the dining room in Aizé. Chenonceau, another of the great 16th century Loire Valley chateaus, was built in part by Thomas Boyer, another financial official who was implicated with Semblancay in the Milan debacle. He died while he was being investigated, and we'll see his chateau next quarter after it's finished in the days of Catherine de' Medici. Francis is said to have observed that Boyer's death was probably due to something wrong in the chest. Francis's symbol was the salamander because it was thought to be impervious to fire, and you can see it on the fireplace here looking as it usually does, more like a dragon than like the slimy little lizard called by the same name. This is called the Red Bedroom in Aizé. It is, Aizé-le-Rideau, one of the six Loire Valley chateaux given 3 stars in the Guide Michelin, and it gets such a high rank primarily for the look of the building itself, its curb appeal, as it were, rather than for the collection of furniture and objets d'art, which is pretty ordinary. Here are the grounds with some 16th century style boats used in the Son et Lumière show. Well, the Constable of Bourbon, as I said, fled after 100 adventures to the court of the new Emperor Charles V, who then put him in command of the Imperial Army in Milan. This is a portrait sketch attributed by some to Titian of Bourbon, who looks every bit the sort of wild man he was. When Francis realized what was happening, he sent Guillaume de Bonnivet to Milan to try to get it back, but about all Bonnivet had to recommend him was the fact that he was a close friend of Francis' sister Margaret. And here's a portrait sketch of Bonnivet now by Jean Clouet. One can, of course, always judge books by their covers, but who would you pick in a fight between these fellows? Bonnivet was defeated by Bourbon in the Battle of Romagnolo in 1524, and Francis resolved to go then and get Milan back himself the next year, 1525. He let Bonnivet talk him into occupying Pavia first, though, to use as a base from which to attack Milan. And this turned out to be a big mistake. The French couldn't even take Pavia, and then Bourbon came down to attack them there. This is a 16th century artist's idea of the Battle of Pavia, which resulted in a catastrophic defeat for Francis, who was captured and turned over to Charles V. As we've heard, this victory led to the imperial occupation of Rome and the virtual imprisonment of the Pope, who had supported the French, and this and Charles V's enmity toward England for not supporting him as he'd expected led to Henry VIII's difficulties in getting his divorce from Catherine of Aragon, which led to the English Reformation. It was an important battle. Francis was hauled off to prison in Spain, which Charles also ruled, where he was held in the Torre de Luan on the old Plaza de la Villa here in Madrid. Before Charles would let him go, he wanted him to, in essence, surrender a good deal of France, surrender to Bourbon the lands he had confiscated from him, marry his, Charles's, sister Eleanor, and turn his 2 sons over to him as a guarantee the other provisions of the agreement would be carried out. Francis refused to sign this for many months, but finally he smuggled out a letter in which he said that any later document he signed in Spain was to be regarded as void in advance. He then signed the treaty Charles wanted with a clear conscience, having no intention to carry it out, at least not all of it. He had to turn his 2 sons over, however, before Charles would let him leave. After his capture at Pavia, he had written to his mother that all had been lost save honor, but you can't turn your 7 and 9 year old sons over to your worst enemy so you can go home and still claim honor. Here's a portrait of Francis now by Titian, which he based on a medallion by Cellini. Francis did also marry the emperor's sister, but they rarely saw one another and had no children. He had already had 7 children by his first wife, Claude, who died at 26. As to turning over territory, however, that was a different matter. When it became clear that Francis was not going to live up to the terms of the treaty, Charles challenged him to a duel, which never came off. It's to Charles's credit that he did no harm to the royal French boys who were at his mercy in Spain. They were eventually released 4 years later, following the payment of a colossal ransom according to the terms of the Pays des Dames, the ladies' peace arranged by the king's mother and Charles's Aunt Margaret. So Francis married Charles's sister, but the most important woman in his life for some time was to be Anne, the Duchesse d'Étampes, seen here in a portrait by Corneille de Lyon, whose style is very different from that of Clouet, whose portraits are usually almost Holbein-like in their treatment of fine detail. Corneille's almost look like they were done with crayons, and they're an odd size. Most portraits done in the Renaissance were either life-size or miniatures. Corneille's are about halfway between the two. Most are about 5 or 6 inches high. The Duchesse d'Étampes became Francis's mistress soon after his return to France and was a major force in court politics till the end of his reign, when she was banished by Francis's son Henry II, whose own mistress Diane de Poitiers was her political rival. She outlived Francis by half a century, however, and died in obscurity. This is the Chateau de Chambord, which Francis had begun before the Battle of Pavia, and which eventually became the largest chateau in the Loire Valley, even though it was never finished. The buildings on the wall were meant to have been continued all the way around it. It is said to have 440 rooms, but that hardly seems possible, even as big a place as it is. The elaborate chimneys give it a distinctive look, as do the watchtowers, from which the ladies of the court could watch the progress of the hunt in the Forêt de Chambord, which still maintains a population of 400 wild boar. In plan, it's set up like a medieval shell-keep fortress, but it has many Renaissance touches, including the open loggias, classical-style pilasters decorating the towers, and a triangular pediment over the entrance through the walls on the park side. The primary architect here was a fellow named Pierre Trinquot. Here you can see the opposite side of the building with the Caussan River in the foreground, which flows into the Loire. Later, Louis XV allowed his father-in-law Stanislaus Leczinska to use it as a temporary residence, and it was given to Marshal Saxe after his famous victory at Fontenoy over the English, about which we'll hear in a few months. We're going to see some more of Chambord now while we hear a piece of music by Pierre Attignon, who was, in addition to being a composer, probably the man we should also consider to be the first publisher to print music in France. And here you get a better look at the roof decorations. After his victory at Marignano in 1515, Francis invited Leonardo da Vinci to come to France, and some think he was responsible for the design of the double spiral staircase here, which is like ones which appear in drawings in his notebooks. But it's unlikely Leonardo was directly involved in any of the plans for this building. It's hard to see what's involved in this picture, but two staircases are entwined around a central axis so that people going down don't run into or even see people coming up. This is Francis's bedroom. This is the Louis XV bedroom, which shows you what decoration will be like in 200 years. This is a view toward the park and forest. Once when I was here, I saw a fellow mowing that lawn with a push mower. He's probably finished by now. And here's a last poetic look at Chambord. Villegongy, southwest of Bourges and not in the Loire Valley, is thought to have also been the work of Trinquot, the architect of Chambord, and it does look a bit like Chambord with the big round towers at the corners and the elaborate chimneys. This is one of the few chateaus in France never open to the public. Viandry was built in the Loire Valley by Jean Le Breton, who was in charge of the management of Chambord. The chateau itself is not of any special importance, but the gardens are considered the finest belonging to any French chateau that is still privately owned, as this is. This is another view. It has ornamental gardens, vegetable gardens, flower gardens. The chateau is open to the public, but it's the gardens people come to see. This is another portrait by Corneille de Lyon, this time of Clement Moreau, the most important French poet between Villon and Ronsard. And you're hearing a poem by him called Le Coeur de Vous, set to music by Claude de Sermacy. His father was also a poet in the circle of those favored by the king, and Clement himself was appointed valet de chambre to Francis and attended him at the Field of the Cloth of Gold. He was captured with him also at Pavia, but let go as a person of no value. Like Villon, he got into a lot of trouble, which, if Francis had not liked his poetry, might have ended his career very early. After he was connected with pro-Protestant rabble-rousing, he fled to the court of Francis's sister, Marguerite of Navarre, who was sympathetic to Protestant ideas, and he also spent time in Geneva and other more Protestant-friendly places, though his reckless lifestyle made him hard to put up with. In 1530, Jacques Lefebvre d'Étaples, known as Johannes or Jacobus Faber, published the first important complete translation of the Vulgate into French, and Moreau also published an independent translation of the Psalms in 1539. His most often anthologized poem is probably the one called Plus ne suis ce que j'étais, No longer am I what I was. He says, no longer am I what I was, nor ever shall I be again. My spring is gone and summer has leaped lightly through the window pane. Love, you've been my master. I've served but thee of God's above. If I could only live again, I'd better serve thee still, O love. This is a portrait by Jean-Claude of Guillaume Boudet. He was a typical student, wine, women, and song until he was 24, when he says he gave up that life for books, and I think that's when he acquired this glum expression. He became Francis's librarian at Fontainebleau, which we'll see shortly. He corresponded with Erasmus and Thomas More, and like them, although critical of the church, he remained within it. He was responsible for persuading Francis to establish the Collège de France in Paris for the teaching of subjects like Hebrew and Greek, which were not offered at the Sorbonne. And the Collège de France is still today a kind of alternative education institution where anyone who wants to can attend the lectures offered for free. It does not, however, grant degrees. This is Clouet's portrait of the king's sister, Marguerite d'Angoulême, or de Navarre, as she became after marrying the nominal king of Navarre, Henri d'Albret. She was herself an important author, and her Heptameron, modeled on Boccaccio's Decameron, is still available in translation in many large bookstores. She was also very tolerant of religious diversity and friendly to Moreau, and as I've mentioned, Calvin and Francois Rabelais, although I don't think she ever invited all of them to the same party. Because of her good nature, it said she was born smiling. And she is smiling, and even her little dog is smiling in this portrait. And smiling portrait subjects were not yet that common, even though Mona Lisa had been painted some 20 years before this. This is Nérac in southwestern France, which was her husband's residence, pretty much in the middle of nowhere. But her generosity attracted many to visit here, including those I've mentioned. Rabelais, who dedicated one of the four books in the Gargantua and Pantagruel cycle to her, was certainly the most important prose author of Francis's day. He is said to have been born here near Chinon in the Loire Valley, the son of a prosperous attorney, although the house doesn't look like the house of a prosperous attorney. Over the course of his life, he was in and out of monastic orders, became a priest and a doctor, and had many friends in high places right up to the king himself and Cardinal Jean du Bellay, who protected him from the wrath of the Sorbonne and other agencies of theological and political power. This is an anonymous portrait of him. Gargantua and Pantagruel, as the whole thing is often called, is a truly bizarre work. What people think of when they hear Rabelais' name mentioned is, of course, his Rabelaisian subject matter, and as Will Durant says, it's true that in reading him one has to be thankful that the printed page doesn't smell. However, there's much more to him than just scatological humor. One of the things he does best is to use his own formidable scholarship to make fun of scholarship. He lists 160 games, 250 unflattering adjectives, 300 different kinds of fools, 90 famous cooks, and so on. He uses the language of academic theology to discuss whether or not a priest who burps, or worse, during Mass has committed a sin, and language appropriate to a discussion of the Trojan War to describe a squabble between cake bakers. He constantly juxtaposes the serious and the ridiculous in a way that great humorists often have. And like a lot of great writers, however, he is not easy to read unless you've already read a lot of what he's read, and most of us today haven't. This is a modern statue of him beside the Loire at Chinon. The Britannica article on him says drolly that his work is not limited by any purpose, but its purpose is certainly at least to make us laugh. And he says, in fact, that laughter is what makes us human. Animals and angels don't think anything is funny, after all. His heroes are great fans of Bacchus, and there are several paeans to drunkenness included. All good men, he says, love wine, and there are more old drunks than old doctors. Gargantua's first words, in fact, as a baby are, "Give me a drink." One of his characters founds a monastery, the motto of which is, "Do whatever you want," and over the gate of which is inscribed, "Gold give us, God forgive us." He says he believes firmly in reincarnation because he wants to be a king so badly, he's sure he must have been one in a past life. On his own deathbed, when he was asked what he thought the fate of his soul would be, he said, "I think I'm going to the great perhaps." This is the Chateau of Villeneuve-Loubet near Nice on the Riviera. The Pays des Dames, which allowed for the return of Francis's sons from Spain in 1530, had no real effect on the enmity which Francis and Charles felt toward one another throughout the 1530s. But in 1539, another agreement, the Treaty of Nice, which provided for a 10-year truce and was signed here, was arranged by Pope Paul III in part in hopes of presenting a more united front against the Turks, whom Francis had been encouraging to attack the empire in the east. Francis then allowed Charles to pass through France on his way to deal with a rebellion in Ghent, and they visited several chateaus together, including Fontainebleau, not far from Paris, which was Francis' chief residence in the later part of his career. There was a chateau here all the way back in the 12th century, around the Cour Oval, toward the back, but little but the shape of that court survives from the era in which it was built. It was abandoned in the Hundred Years' War, the whole chateau, and then in 1527, after returning from Madrid, Francis began restoring and adding to it using the talents of the Italian artists he'd invited here, who are known collectively as the First School of Fontainebleau. The staircase to the Galerie François Premier, the Francis I Gallery, was added by Louis XIII, and the right wing, which now houses the Musée Napoléon, was added by Louis XV. Napoleon did spend several months here before his abdication and made his famous farewell speech standing on that staircase. From the end of World War II to 1966, it was the headquarters of the U.S. Army in Europe. We'll see more of Fontainebleau in a minute, but the most famous artist of the first school of Fontainebleau was Benvenuto Cellini, whose gold salt cellar made for Francis is now in the Vienna Art History Museum. The figures are Neptune and a lady identified as the Earth Goddess. You might wonder where the salt goes in a thing like this. It was put in a little boat on the other side of the goddess's leg. Pepper was put in the container with the reclining nude on the lid. Cellini is also famous for his bronze Perseus, now in the Bargello in Florence, and for his autobiography, which is very informative about life at Fontainebleau, but which is so full of arrogance and exaggeration it's by no means always a reliable historical source. Certainly the artists in Francis's stable of Italians did not always get along with one another. Cellini once threatened to kill Francesco Primaticcio, and Il Rosso committed suicide. Perhaps Cellini's most celebrated claim in the autobiography is his statement that he shot the Constable of Bourbon while the latter was besieging the Castle San Angelo in Rome. Maybe he did. Somebody did, because that's where that wild man's career ended. This is the Gallery François Premier now, the part of Fontainebleau that best represents what the place looked like in his day. Il Rosso did the stucco work and much of the painting until he committed suicide. Primaticcio then became the primary decorator. The paintings are mostly based on classical mythology. In this example, Venus is scolding Cupid. While we see more of Fontainebleau now, we're going to hear one of the great songs of Francis's day by Thoinot Arbeau. It's called La Belle qui tient ma vie, the woman who holds my life in her hands, as it were. This was the bedroom of the Duchesse d'Etampes, but Louis XIII cut the floor out for a staircase. The decor depicts the loves of the gods. Here's a closer view of some of that decoration. The library, but it was entirely redecorated in the 19th century. This is the ballroom, which was finished by Francis's son, Henry II, about whom we'll hear next quarter. This is a view of the chateau from the lake, which has the little pavilion on it where Napoleon liked to have dinner. A last look at the whole place from the grounds. And this is a portrait sketch of the king by Dumonstier. Francis is supposed to have laughed out loud when he heard that Henry VIII had died in 1547, but he didn't have long to live himself and died also later that year. His heir was Henry, the younger of the two boys who had been imprisoned in Spain and who had outlived his older brother. Understandably, he had never been that close to his father and was hardly sorry to become the King of France himself. We'll hear all about him and his famous wife Catherine de' Medici and his famous mistress Diane de Poitiers. Next quarter. Here are the gisants of Francis and his first wife Claude at Saint-Denis. Philibert Delorme, the most important French sculptor and architect of the day, was responsible for this work, and we'll also hear more about him next quarter as the architect of the most celebrated part of the Château of Chenonceau and of Diane de Poitiers' Château at Annette as well. It's convenient that Francis and Henry VIII died in the same year, because that means that we can go right back to England now for the coronation of Henry VIII's son, Edward VI. And here's a picture of the coronation procession passing St. Paul's Cathedral as it looked in the 16th century. Edward was only 10, and the regent for him was, as I mentioned earlier, his uncle Edward Seymour, Duke of Somerset, the brother of Queen Jane. The new king's tutor was Cranmer, who had made sure that his outlook would be Protestant, and Cranmer's own Book of Common Prayer was ordered to be used in all English churches, while celebration of the Roman Catholic Mass was declared illegal. This is a portrait by Holbein of Edward, painted when the future king was the 6-year-old Prince of Wales. Somerset had to deal with all sorts of serious problems, from the religious issue to trouble with Scotland and France to the discontent of the poor to the dangerous ambitions of his own brother. He was no religious fanatic himself, and though many Catholics were imprisoned for their activities, only 2 were executed during Edward's reign. Somerset defeated the Scots at Pinkie Cleugh, but followed this with generous treaty terms, and he was sympathetic to the poor. For this kind of relatively cool-headed approach, especially compared to Henry's stormy vindictiveness before him, he's been almost unanimously praised by historians. This is a portrait of Somerset's brother, Thomas Seymour, who was one of his worst problems. Thomas courted both Mary Tudor and Queen Elizabeth in hopes of getting to be king in some way, and finally settled for marrying Henry VIII's widow, Catherine Parr. He was made Lord High Admiral to stop the piracy in the Channel, and in effect joined the pirates. When he was caught conspiring to overthrow the regency, Somerset finally had to order him arrested, and he was executed in 1549. These dangerous activities of his brother certainly undermined Somerset's own authority, but what really caused his downfall was the rebellion of the peasants led by Robert Kett. Somerset was accused by John Dudley, the Earl of Warwick, who also claimed the title Duke of Northumberland, of being soft on poverty and of having brought the rebellion of Kett on by his allegedly pro-peasant policies. This is Sion House near London as it looks today. Somerset had acquired the abbey that was here when Henry closed the monasteries, and he turned it into a residence, but it was almost entirely rebuilt in the 18th century. Somerset finally sent Warwick against the rebel peasant army, and he defeated it, which just made him a man of even more influence. This is the so-called Elizabethan gallery at Sion House. But as I said, it's really 18th century. Warwick, in conjunction with other large landowners and the nobility, was then able to deprive Somerset of the regency, which he claimed for himself, and the deposed regent was executed in 1552. Warwick also confiscated Sion House here, as well as Somerset House in London, which stood where the colossal later building of the same name stands on the Strand. Durant says that Warwick's regency was distinguished for its corruption, even in an age of corruption. And he was soon one of the most unpopular men in England. This is another portrait by Holbein of Edward VI before he became king. His health by the time of Warwick's assumption of the regency was rapidly weakening, and he was not able to have any real say in his nominal protector's policies. His signature was simply forged on the order for Somerset's execution. Warwick knew, however, that when Edward died, he would be out of a job. The will of Henry VIII called for Edward, should he have no heir, to be succeeded by Mary Tudor, who was no friend of Warwick. In a desperate attempt to hold power, Warwick had his son Guildford married to the 15-year-old Lady Jane Grey, whom you see here in a portrait by someone called Master John. Jane was the granddaughter of Henry VIII's sister Mary and Charles Brandon, the Duke of Suffolk. Warwick then had the dying boy king void Henry VIII's will and name Jane his successor over Mary Tudor. This was obviously a very dangerous step to take. Edward died on July 6, 1553, and on July 9th, the reluctant Jane was proclaimed Queen of England by Warwick's hand-picked Privy Council. However, the next day, Mary Tudor proclaimed herself queen at Norfolk, and Warwick's own army refused to act against her in support of such a flagrant disregard of the rules of succession and the will of Henry VIII. Certainly a majority of Englishmen were also still Catholic in sympathy, at least, and Warwick had more than his share of Protestant enemies as well. When he was discovered to have been negotiating with the French to bring about an invasion to support him, even his own Privy Council recoiled and welcomed Mary to London with almost everyone else on August 3rd. Warwick, his son Guildford, and the short-reigned Queen Jane were all arrested and executed. This is an anonymous portrait of Mary, who ardently hoped to be able to restore England to Catholicism, but who was at first remarkably tolerant, saying she would constrain no one in the matter of religious belief. It soon became clear, however, that even if Protestants were still in the minority, almost all had passed the point of no return. They refused to go back to Catholicism, and they refused to be tolerant. Cranmer denounced the Mass's abominable blasphemy, and Ridley, the Anglican Bishop of London, denounced Mary herself as a bastard, and both were imprisoned in the Tower. In 1554, Mary, realizing that to be tolerant was to lose, made the holding of any Protestant service illegal. And also in that year, she married Philip II of Spain, than whom no one was more Catholic. Antonis More, about whom we'll hear more next quarter, painted this engagement portrait of Mary shortly before her marriage. More was Dutch by birth, but went to Spain to work for Philip, and painted this portrait in England for him. It's now in the Prado. Protestants were, of course, appalled by this marriage, and even many Catholics were opposed to it. After some desperate Protestants made an attempt to overthrow Mary before the wedding could take place, she reacted violently, and in the remainder of her reign, some 300 were burned at the stake, for which reason she is, of course, known as Bloody Mary. Philip stayed in England only about a year and then left. He returned briefly in 1557, but she never saw him again after that, and probably fortunately for both countries, they had no children. After 2 years in the Tower, Cranmer was executed in Oxford, where this monument is today. After Ridley was burned at the stake on October 6, 1555, Cranmer recanted his views in hopes of avoiding that fate. But Mary ordered his execution anyway. Before he was led to the pyre, he then took back his recantation and said that the hand that had signed it would be stretched first into the fire, and so it was. A.F. Pollard says that his recantation of his recantation was a repentance of which he need not repent. Mary herself, whom Durant calls England's most hated queen, and Winston Churchill calls England's least successful and unhappiest ruler, died in 1558, after just 5 years as England's first queen regnant, not counting Jane Grey. One of the best things she did was confirm that Elizabeth was to be her successor, knowing full well that she was no Catholic at heart, and England's most hated queen was then succeeded by its most beloved. So after the break, we'll hear about Elizabeth I.